The Introverted Leader, Building on Your Quiet Strength. Written by Jennifer B. Kahnweiler, PhD. Narrated by Tiffany Williams. Foreword. Every time I've taken a Myers-Briggs test, I've scored high on the introversion scale. As an introvert, I get energy from being by myself. I sometimes feel drained if I have to be in front of large groups of people I don't know for an extended period of time. And, as addressed in this book, people exhaustion takes its toll. After I've been in a social situation, including a long day at work, I need quiet time to be alone with my thoughts, reflect on the day, and recharge. But as CEO of Campbell's Soup Company, a company with nearly 20,000 employees, I found myself particularly challenged because so much of my work required me to be out there in front of others. Not only that, but I was also challenged to reverse a precipitous decline in market value in a hurry. Over the course of my tenure, we succeeded in dramatically transforming the global leadership team, reconfiguring the portfolio, cutting costs, and making strategic investments in Campbell's products, marketing programs, innovation pipeline, and infrastructure. As a result, the company was able to deliver cumulative shareholder returns in the top tier of the global food industry. Now, as founder and CEO of Conant Leadership, I have perhaps an even less introverted job. To help improve the quality of leadership in the 21st century, I often stand in front of a room full of people and talk about how they, too, can be effective leaders in their organizations. One might ask how an introvert like myself makes this happen. Good question. I'd be lying if I said that there wasn't a point in my life when I didn't aspire to be more outgoing, but it's just not in my nature. When I was nearly 50, I began to realize that the best thing for me to do was to tell everyone with whom I worked the simple truth. I'm just shy. I realized that people are not mind readers. I needed to let them know what I was thinking and how I was feeling. Eventually, I developed this little talk, affectionately known as the DRC orientation, in which I shared with people the essence of who I was and what I was trying to do. I would tell it to new employees right off the bat. I did this so all the people with whom I worked would have a clear idea of who I am, where I come from, and what I expect everyone to do in order to succeed. I found that declaring my introversion was a very freeing exercise, more preferred than going through the painful contortions and attempting to adapt to other people's styles. I have pursued this practice for well over 10 years, and it really has helped me build strong relationships and quickly get beyond all the little superficial dances people do when they first start working with each other. I have found that you need to make a conscious effort to develop your skill set. At one point in my career, the CEO of Nabisco wanted me to be president of the sales organization. I said, "You have got to be kidding me. A, I'm an introvert, and B, I can't play golf." Still, I ultimately accepted that position. I had to step even further out of my comfort zone, what Jennifer describes as the push component of her 4 P's process. Emotionally, it was by far the most challenging job I've ever had, but I had to step up to the challenge. Making this stretch was necessary for me to grow as an effective leader and was very helpful in preparing me to become a CEO. The introverted leader respects and honors those strengths introverts bring to the table and also offers a process whereby introverts get results. Jennifer's 4 P's process, preparation, presence, push, and practice, has been proven based on the tangible lessons she has gleaned from working with thousands of successful introverted leaders. This process provides introverts with a practical application for many challenging scenarios, from public speaking and networking to running a Fortune 500 company. Both introverts and extroverts can learn from reading this book. Undoubtedly, introverts exist in all types of organizations. You simply can't overlook this entire group of contributors. Most people think of leaders as being outgoing, very visible, and charismatic people. I find that perspective to be overly narrow. You might just find that you have introverts embedded in your organization, and undoubtedly, some of them are natural-born leaders. The key challenge for leaders today is to get beyond the surface and unlock the full potential of all their colleagues. At times, extroverts may get to leadership positions faster, but for us introverts, it's all about working at our own pace and, at the end of the day, performing in a full way. Introverts can absolutely be extremely effective leaders. The landscape is full of excellent examples. This book shows you how to increase your awareness and effectiveness in the workplace. If you are an extrovert, you will better understand and appreciate what your introverted teammates have to offer. If you are an introvert, you will gain insights and practical steps to build on your quiet strength. Ultimately, what helps all of us most is to embrace and fully leverage who we are in order to make the most substantial contributions possible. This book shows you how to do just that. Douglas R. Conant, former president and CEO of Campbell Soup Company, CEO, Conant Leadership. Preface. I'm perfectly happy being alone, as long as there are books and thoughts. Arianna Huffington. The Rise of the Introverts. Introverts rock. People often think that a big, vibrant personality is needed to succeed in the workplace. That simply is not true. Often it is the quietest people who have the loudest minds. Unfortunately, many introverts feel excluded, overlooked, or misunderstood, and our workplace cultures are still skewed toward extroverts. The hopeful news, however, is that introverts are finding their voice, and the world is starting to awaken to the power of introverted leaders. When I wrote the first edition of The Introverted Leader 8 years ago, it was before introversion was part of the global conversation. Back then, people asked me if the title was an oxymoron. How can you be a leader and an introvert? They asked. One reporter writing on the subject told me that she couldn't get any senior leaders to admit on the record that they were introverts. The bias about quieter leaders was pronounced. I continually had to explain how introvert traits such as listening, preparation, and calmness are great qualities found in excellent leaders. My consulting work had shown me the need for a book that laid out a framework for introverted leaders to succeed. Though I searched, I couldn't find any books on the topic, so I decided to write one. I knew that introverts needed a practical guide for becoming successful leaders, but I didn't expect the passionate and appreciative reactions that I received from around the world after the book was published. The Introverted Leader has been translated into multiple languages, and I have spoken to groups from Singapore to Spain. Readers were grateful that the leadership challenges introverts face were finally being addressed, and they appreciated the strategies the book provided. Focusing on introverted leaders was an idea whose time had come. Today, a strong case is being made for the importance of reorganizing and valuing introverts' gifts and contributions. Writers such as Susan Cain, Sophia Dembling, Beth Bulow, Lori Helgo, Nancy Ankowitz, and many others have added their voices to the call for introvert strengths to be recognized and appreciated. There are at least 50 blogs and countless popular videos now devoted to introverts. I call this phenomenon the rise of the introverts. Introverts are embracing who they really are instead of trying to change themselves into some extroverted image of who they think they should be. As a longtime champion of introverts, I am so pleased at this evolution. The next wave for introverted leaders. I see the next wave of the introvert revolution as going beyond equipping people with more skills to adapt to extrovert-dominant cultures. The revolution will be about transforming cultures to become more inclusive. This is starting to take hold in organizations across the world, where diversity of style and temperament is becoming increasingly important to consider, in addition to attention to race, ethnicity, and gender. For example, hiring managers are thinking about how to get the best from introverts in interviews. Senior leaders are reflecting on how workspaces can be set up to give introverts places to retreat and reflect. Meetings are being structured to include both writing and talking time. Companies realize that focusing on introverts makes good business sense. Organizations addressing the topic of introverted leaders include Freddie Mac, NASA, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, and Evolent Health. A number of professional associations, such as the American Library Association, the Society of Human Resource Management, and the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, have sponsored programs on introverted leadership to raise awareness of this important topic. New research. As mentioned, in 2008, little if any research on introverted leadership existed. Now, a growing list of research studies and media coverage provide intriguing new data about introverted leaders. For the first time, serious academic research is being conducted on the qualities of introverts, the conditions introverts need to best perform, the correlation between introverted leadership and company performance, and even on the brains of introverts. This academic work shows no signs of slowing down. I include highlights from such research in this edition. Over the past decade, I have also conducted research using surveys, interviews, and case study analysis. From my consulting work, I have collected many new insights. Based on the questions from our community, I researched what makes introverts successful at work, including how they influence and work with extroverts to achieve strong results. After The Introverted Leader, I wrote Quiet Influence and The Genius of Opposites, both based on this research. This 2018 edition of The Introverted Leader builds on that work as well. Who this book is for? Leaders at any level, including project managers and professionals who must influence others to get results, will find this book valuable. New niche audiences have emerged for the book as part of a burgeoning community, including senior executives, women in technology, Asian leaders, salespeople, and those who lead introverts. If you're a leader of people or projects, you likely have introverts on your team. This book will help you better understand introverts and maximize their contributions. If you have read the first edition, welcome back. You will find strategies and information to support you on your leadership journey. My background. Frequently, introverted readers and event participants tell me, "You get me." I can think of no greater compliment. As an extroverted consultant, speaker, trainer, and leadership coach for more than 25 years, I know that I will never truly know what it is like to live in an introvert's world. I have been influenced by the introverts I set out to influence, I once wrote. That still holds true. A good part of my learning has emerged from being married to an introvert for 44 years. My spouse, Bill, has taught me to appreciate the values of quiet reflection, listening, and simply slowing down. Bill has led by example, which for me is the best way to learn. Though I am energized by people, I have become more comfortable hanging out with myself. I now carve out and welcome the opportunity for solitude and quiet time. My approach. I have interviewed and collected data from hundreds of introverted leaders across a wide range of industries. Some interviews were structured with set questions. Others I conducted in preparation for speeches and training programs. Wearing my journalist hat, I filled notebooks with observations. I found that posing specific questions on social networking sites yielded provocative thoughts from introverts who prefer expressing their ideas and feelings in writing. This new edition also draws upon the unique perspectives of leading academics and business thinkers. Book overview. We start off in the introduction by highlighting the definition and benefits of introverted leadership. Chapter 1 focuses on the 6 key challenges that most introverts face at work, including people exhaustion, dealing with a fast pace, getting interrupted, feeling pressure to self-promote, coping with an emphasis on teams, and handling negative impressions. The framework of the book is introduced in Chapter 2, where you'll learn about the four P's: prepare, presence, push, and practice. This is based on my research with successful introverted leaders. In reflecting on the steps they've taken to use their natural quiet strengths, these leaders continually described four steps for every leadership scenario they encounter. They prepare well, they are present and stay in the moment, they push themselves out of their comfort zones, and they practice consistently. The four P's also serves as an effective coaching tool. Chapter 3 offers a newly revised introverted leader quiz. Your answers will provide a snapshot of which leadership strategies are currently working for you and which you can enhance. These results can serve as a springboard for further discussions with your manager and teammates. In chapters 4 through 9, you will learn how to apply the steps of the 4P's process to confidently navigate typical workplace scenarios: leading people, heading up projects, giving presentations, running and contributing to meetings, networking, communicating, coaching, and managing up. Each chapter includes a host of practical tools and approaches for you to immediately apply. Chapter 10, Results of Using the 4P's Process, addresses the many benefits you gain by focusing on your strengths. Finally, Chapter 11 helps you pull it all together by syncing up the 4P's with your next action steps so you have a workable way forward. Feel free to read the chapters sequentially or dive selectively into those chapters that pique your interest. My hope is that, as readers of the first edition did, you will find the lessons contained here helpful on your leadership journey, and you will share the learning you discover with others. I hope you find the process productive and satisfying. Introduction. What is an introverted leader? Is it essential for you to have quiet time after being with people? Do you sometimes feel that your voice is not heard? Have you found that you are sometimes passed over for career opportunities? If you answered yes to any of these questions, you might be an introvert. It doesn't mean that you are shy, don't enjoy people, or can't collaborate with others. You probably draw your energy from within yourself. Most likely, you're fine being with people, but after a while, you become drained from expending social energy. The model of successful leadership must expand from one that emphasizes extroversion to one that includes introverts. With the great problems our organizations face today, we are surely losing out by not tapping into more than half of our population and acknowledging the many gifts of introversion. Introverts bring tremendous strengths to the challenges of leading a team. When they harness these quiet strengths, they can be powerful leaders. Introverts also have unique qualities that make them particularly suited to leading people toward greater results. Many brilliant and accomplished leaders from all walks of life and professions have shown the way. Respected figures such as GM CEO Mary Barra, Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, Microsoft founder Bill Gates, Federal Reserve Chief Janet Yellen, financier Warren Buffett, and actor and gender rights activist Emma Watson are just a few examples of current accomplished introverts. Other famous introverts from history include Mother Teresa, Nelson Mandela, Abraham Lincoln, Eleanor Roosevelt, and Martin Luther King Jr. They found ways to draw upon their quiet power to achieve greatness. Defining introverts. Psychologist Carl Jung first defined introversion as energy being generated from within yourself. Think of your energy as if it were a battery. Extroverts charge their batteries by being with people. Introverts draw their battery power by going within. At this point, it may be helpful to highlight the common characteristics of introverts and extroverts. Introverts. Energized by solitude. Must have breaks. Reserved. Express thoughts after reflection. Private at first. Low-key facial expression. Prefer writing. Like small group, one-on-one focused conversations. Humble. need time to prepare, calm. Extroverts, energized by other people, breaks are nice but not required. Enthusiastic, express thoughts immediately, share openly, expressive face, prefer talking, prefer larger groups where they can move fast and change topics, talk about their accomplishments, wing it, excited. The bell curve. Most people typically fall somewhere in the middle range of the introvert-extrovert, i.e., spectrum. Think of it as a bell curve. There are outliers or people at extreme ends of the curve, but most of us lean slightly toward one side or the other. Where you are can be determined by how important it is for you to have a break after being with people. If you must have a break, then most likely you are more introverted. If taking a break from people is nice but not necessary, you may fall on the extroverted side. Some research has been done on a concept called ambiversion. Similar to ambidextrous people who use either hand to write, ambiverts tend to shift between introversion and extroversion. An example is salespeople who must listen deeply, an introvert strength, and also be able to talk enthusiastically about their products, an extrovert strength. We all have many different assets. It comes down to a matter of degree and how we use them. Selecting behavior over labels. In my work with thousands of introverted leaders, I find that the most successful are those who are self-aware and understand their need to quietly reflect. They don't get hung up on labeling themselves I or E. When assessing a situation, they select the best behaviors to use. Sometimes it is speaking up, and sometimes it is deep listening. As you will read in this book, self-knowledge and self-acceptance yield strong results. The most effective introverted leaders are conscious of their choices. They see the value of tapping into the reflective side while also recognizing when extrovert behaviors are useful. The difference between shyness and introversion. Introversion is not the same thing as being shy. Shyness is driven by social or psychological anxiety, and it can be debilitating. According to the American Psychological Association, shyness can keep people from interacting with others even when they want or need to, leading to problems in relationships and at work. While shyness and introversion sometimes overlap, introversion is about how you are naturally wired. It is not a problem, flaw, or something to overcome. Many introverted leaders describe childhood experiences of being labeled shy. They also say that gaining life experience helped them outgrow shyness and they learned different ways of handling social situations. Validating introvert strengths. I often ask for volunteers in my primarily introverted audiences to call out loud the strengths of introverts. There is no shortage of answers as people let their words land. Starting like a light rain shower, they say, observers, listeners. And then a torrent emerges. Writers, humorists, reflectors, calm, resilient, and so on. You can see people sit up straighter as the list of introvert talents and contributions gets longer and they are reminded of their talents. Now is the time for introverted leaders. Before I deliver a speech or begin a training program, I typically connect with a representative cross-section of people who will be attending. I ask about their challenges. Their passionate responses reflect themes such as not being heard and biases, hidden and overt, toward people who are not the first ones to talk or who didn't exhibit high energy. In Chapter 1, Six Key Challenges for Introverts, you will see those obstacles described in detail. Perhaps you will relate to some of them. Introverted leaders can harness their quiet strengths to meet these challenges. Expanding the model of leadership beyond one based on extroversion can also yield several key benefits, which include solving pressing problems. Introverts' strengths help organizations to innovate, compete, and lead in a global, digital, and diverse marketplace. The creativity and brain power of introverts are needed to inspire new ideas, challenge the status quo, and solve pressing world problems, such as alleviating climate change and curing cancer. Every day, these qualities are needed to help our teams and organizations succeed. Increasing engagement. Introverts make up between 40 to 60% of the workforce, and according to Gallup, 70% of workers worldwide are not engaged. We can't afford to miss this huge opportunity to tap into introvert power. By engaging introverts, retention increases as people tend to stay with companies where they are contributing and recognized. Creating productive workspaces. Workplaces that address introverts' needs offer spaces for both collaboration and solitude. They also make remote options available. These flexible spaces benefit productivity and are performance boosters for everyone, introverts, extroverts, and ambiverts. Enabling extroverts to tap into their introverted side. As introverts gain respect and recognition, extroverted colleagues tend to become more aware of their own quiet strengths. By taking even a short pause, for instance, extroverts optimize their own performance and hear the thoughts of others, which benefits the entire organization. Accomplishing more together. Diverse teams can accomplish more than homogeneous teams. Introverts and extroverts working together bring the full range of their strengths to projects. Genius opposites, those introverts and extroverts who achieve strong results, offer a range of solutions and brain power to clients and customers that is exponential. For more on genius opposites, see my book, The Genius of Opposites. We face tremendous problems in our workplaces and the world at large. Our organizations, teams, individuals, and ultimately our planet will benefit when we highlight and harness these strengths, reaping the broad range of introvert talent available to us. Chapter 1. 6 Key Challenges for Introverts. The challenges. Imagine this scenario. For the fifth time at the staff meeting, the team leader asks what questions people have. A group of emerging leaders, mostly engineers, falls silent. Rather than engage people by requesting they review materials prior to the meeting and write down their ideas and questions before speaking, the leader runs the meeting as she always has. She moves through the agenda quickly, expecting people to speak up voluntarily and share ideas aloud. This delivery strategy is geared toward extroverts, and they aren't even in the room. The result? The leader moved forward with actions based on her own ideas, with little buy-in and commitment from the group. Consequently, they felt overlooked and ignored. This scenario is all too common. While introverts increasingly recognize and own their strengths, it is hard to push through the deep-rooted, often subtle bias that caters to extroverts' preferences. The traditional view of leaders is that they speak confidently and assertively, and they clamor to be the center of attention. They take control and shoot from the hip and lay it on the line. We still live in a world where the extroverted ideal shapes many aspects of leadership in our workplace. As you will see in this book, the research loudly and clearly refutes this assumption. Naming the challenges. In my studies, 6 key themes emerge as significant barriers for introverted leaders. People exhaustion, a fast pace, getting into.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.